Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Waterbury Board of Education workshop. I'd like to begin with a silent prayer and ask Commissioner Theriault to say a few words about the passing of Alderman Frank Bergio.
What can I say about a man who meant so much to so many? Husband, vet, father, uncle, grandfather, alderman, police commissioner, contagious politician, and courageous politician, and friend. While Frank Bergio was small in stature, he was a giant in the world of Waterbury politics. Frank died the way he lived, courageously, battling the cancer that took his life right to the end. Frank was not the shy type and was always ready to share his opinions and words of wisdom with anyone that would listen. And sometimes that person wished they had never started the conversation. The city of Waterbury will sadly miss Frank for all his contributions that he made in the political world, in the community, and his family and friends. We wish him well and peace, and God bless him. Thank you.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First on the agenda is Mr. Branker and Durham Transportation concerning the Durham bus tracker.
Thank you, Madam President. For the record, with me is Jeff Hunter, our manager of pupil transportation. We also have, from the Durham Bus Company, Steve Schmuck and Pam Pratt. They're over there. Steve has a presentation. Pam is our local coordinator. Steve is a regional coordinator. Thanks. You had asked for a presentation on Durham Bus Tracker. We're ready. Here we are. And we're ready to implement after you approve.
Great.
As soon as he gets the slide presentation.
Yes, I just need to plug it in.
Go ahead. Before we begin, I'd like to remind you there's no cost for this app. It was part of the bus contract when it was signed.
Great.
And Durham has used this extensively throughout the United States. And Canada. Thank you. Okay.
All right, super. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. You should have had in your agendas a packet, a handout of the actual brochures. This is an actual duplication of it, just a more color format, a little bit better material, print stock, so we can share those with you guys. So what I'd like to do is kind of take you through a day in the life of the application and what it would mean for you guys and the community and the parents and how it works. Just take you through.
Madam President, if I may, just for a quick minute. If anyone in the audience, because I invited some parents down, wants to see this presentation, please feel free to move up so you can see it. Thank you.
Okay, great. Thank you. I apologize, it's kind of off to the side. So I'm going to take you through kind of a simple point and click on the application, how it works, and then we can get into some, you know, some questions and talk about answers, privacy, security rights, and general usage. I have it plugged in right now, and I'm running it from a laptop, which is usable through a website. So as you can see, if you're on a home computer or at a work, you can log into a website and actually use the application with your username, your password that you create. Or it's also available through mobile applications on cell phones. if I had an HDMI hookup on the PowerPoint, I could have actually ran the presentation right from my phone. But it is available through the App Store, through Apple, and then through Google Play. So the droids and et cetera, those two markets. So when you download this application, it's a free download for the parents or for whoever wants to do it. It's called the Durham Bus Tracker. And what it does is creates just a portal for you to get into our system with the right securities and the right link to the student ID or information, and then create access to you to view the route, the bus that's assigned to the route for the child that you have, for the information that you have. So you can't see any other people, their children, where the child is specifically, it's only where the bus is. So it's going off the bus GPS information in the current location based on the current routing. So how that works is obviously all of our buses have the GPS. It's live time. We can see where they are. And it links with our VersaTrans, with our software system that we do routing with. So as long as we have the right student information that we upload from the district into our system and put onto a route and assign them to a bus stop, which is also inclusive of a bus in a school, if we have that information flow through and get into our system, it'll automatically upload and refresh every night. So if there's a change, the new stop or the new bus, new school, a new student maybe, would take place the next day. And it actually refreshes by the day, by the route set. So if I log in the morning and go to look, it's going to pull the AM route sets. Or if it's in the afternoon, it'll pull up the PM route sets. So what I think what I'd like to do, go ahead.
So you tie the last name, service center location, student ID, and that is the only thing that one person can track at any one point in time, right?
Yeah, it's okay. It goes by state,
right,
and then location within the state, mm-hmm. Then it goes by student ID in our VersaTrans system, mm-hmm. And then it goes to, it has to match by last name, right. Exact spelling. If you get any of those wrong, you're getting no information.
Yeah, the logical is all four of them combined
good.
Together.
They have to be, yes.
Okay. Good, okay.
Yep. So I think what would be helpful, maybe I can just kind of point and yeah. click yeah. and yeah. let you kind of see how that looks and what it looks like. Again, on an application, you can kind of see things a little bit better. So on a projection, it's going to be a little bit different. So when I log into it for the first time, it's going to create a profile. Which is anyone can go in, you create a username and an email address and a password that's specific to you or a parent. And with that, you get in access to the Durham Bus Tracker app, which at this point is blank. It would have nothing in it because there's no student information. But with student information, when you get the user ID for the student and those logical state, location, last name, exact spelling, you'd go in and you'd add students. And when you add the students in, you can then go in and view routes. Now, the information that's in here, there is some information in here. It's false information. It's from a different state even. So it's just for demo purposes for you guys. But in this case, it's showing a student bus location. It's saying they're assigned to a bus 14235. It's showing the actual route schematic, which is what's designed for that route schedule. It's showing you the as-of date and time. And then it's going to show you where the bus is located at this point in time, exactly. So at this point in time, that bus is located at Lark Industrial Drive in Smithfield, Rhode Island. And so all these points on the map are actual bus stops that show up along the route sheet. It won't show the stop being completed. It'll just show where the bus is on the map. So if you're logging in, you want to see if the bus went by already. You can log in quickly, and if you see the bus down here, you know, further west on Putnam Pike, then you'd know that it's already driven by your bus stop. This stop here that shows your actual, a little picture of a child on there, which might be hard for you guys to see from over there, it's actually the bus stop that's assigned to that student that it shows. And it shows that it's supposed to be at 2:06 p.m. Greenville Ave in Hillcrest, so it shows you what time the bus should be there. And it shows you the actual stop location. And this map can be enlarged. It's kind of a direct link to a Google map. So you can zoom in, you can zoom out, you can drag it around, very similar to normal maps online or on your phone. So let me go up here and just click on the bus route. And so it's actually going to show you specifically the bus route in writing. So you can actually see Putnam at Haiti, 154, and so on. So you can see what that bus is going to be doing. And that's, again, for the student that you have the ID for with all those logical connections and how the route sheet is lined. The one that's highlighted would always show where your student is supposed to get off, where they're scheduled to get off. If you have multiple students, which many of us do, in the different school districts, you can click on the drop-down, and it would show up all the students that you've registered and added. So if you have a kid in elementary or another student in high school, it'll show each of the children that you've registered and added. And again, you can go in on the map, and if you've got multiple people, multiple students registered in, it'll show multiple buses on the map, and you can pick which one you want to look at, or bus routes. So that, I mean, it's really kind of that simple as far as clicking around and using. It's a great tool to really kind of mitigate some of those easy phone calls of where's the bus, is it running late, is it early, did it go by? It's very helpful with that. Again, it's not going to show whether the student got on or off the bus. It's not going to show whether they did get off, if they were on.
Could I ask one question? How does the person, the parent or guardian, get the ID of the child?
So as we look to launch and roll out the deployment of the application and the right communication messaging that we're going to provide to the public, I think that's at that point we need to decide as a group collectively where that number is coming from. Okay. I think that's why we talk about this first.
That's the most important thing to me, the privacy and who gets that number to track that bus.
That's correct.
Okay.
So that's something that we will work with you and partner with you on however that message needs to be deployed. In the application, I should say and point out.
We could use our student management system to generate a key for families and parents like we do now with our student with Progress Book for online access.
Okay.
So we can use something similar to that.
Good.
So it's we don't have a million sign-ons. So we'll work together on making sure that something works.
I just want to make sure that the only approved guardian or parent gets that ID.
Yeah, correct. Same type of thing. So we'll work together in figuring out a solution.
Chuck?
Who holds that keychain of those four variables for the logical? Does Durham or does the city of Waterbury?
Well, currently it's their solution, so we'd have to work together on either providing them with ours or we could use theirs and somehow link it to the current account that we have.
Sidebar question, who holds, is that your website or your organization holding them or do you outsource it to a third party?
This is all proprietary. It's in-house software. We have...
That's not my question. I understand that.
Okay.
Who holds the data? You internally or you go outside?
We actually use, if I understand it correctly, your question, we actually use a partnership through Google servers, in Atlanta, which has a disaster recovery.
I'm just looking more on the secure standpoint of the database.
Yeah. I think our organization is managed through the Atlanta servers through a partnership with Google.
Yeah, and that's going to lead to actually why I'm here tonight, to talk about the Student Data Privacy Act and kind of the safeguards in place, and maybe we have to probably move forward with a contract to ensure that student data privacy, SSL encryption, that the protections are in place with their servers that we comply with PA 16189. So,
Commissioner Sweeney.
Yep, I have huge concerns here for parents who don't care to have their children tracked. And I know it's tracking the bus, but once somebody knows that the child is on that bus, they're tracking the child regardless. So I would like to know if, at any given time in this district, we have children who may be in serious domestic violence situations who would not want to be tracked by outside people other than a single parent or guardian. And, you can talk to me all day about a secure ID, but quite frankly, all it takes is for one person to leave a piece of paper out where someone can view, or a friend to talk to somebody else, or I need to give this information to a sitter today who is now not my sitter or my friend tomorrow, and that information is out there. And I have huge concerns about that. So I would like to know if there has been any historical information on have there been issues where there's a domestic violence issue and a non-custodial parent has tracked a bus and met a bus before the child would normally get off. Have there been issues where people who should not have that information do have that information and are meeting children who are getting off the bus in semi-secluded areas before they get to their homes, because we have children who walk from the bus stop to their homes? I have a lot of concerns here, a lot of concerns. And telling me that you're going to have a student ID and only one person is going to have that login, I'm quite frankly don't believe that that's going to be the case all the time, every child. I don't.
And actually, that's what I'm here again tonight for, that privacy, the Student Privacy Act, allows parents to opt out. So we have to, once this contract is signed and we move forward, we have to notify every parent through the way we're currently doing it now, provide a letter, provide the contract up on the website for them to review, and give them the option to opt out. So if there is a parent who has those concerns, they always have the option of opting out, and we'd have to delete the record. They'd have to delete the record of that student, so it won't be up there.
So if someone has this ID number, because the custodial parent, I agree, could opt out and not ever set that up. But if that student's ID numbers gets into someone else's hand, they have enough information to log onto the system and create a password and a login for themselves.
Well, that's what we have to. I can't answer that yet because we haven't created the ID. It's not going to be something that somebody would just, can just actually randomly select and put in. You know, we'd work on something.
Well, you're correct, Commissioner Sweeney, but there's no difference between what we will have in the future with this system than what occurs today.
That's right.
Your babysitter today knows the bus route. We publish the routes in the newspaper at the start of the year. They know what time the bus is approximately going to stop at the stop. So tomorrow, the sitter is no longer your sitter, and I mean, God forbid somebody has malicious intent. They could do it whether we have it electronically tracking the bus or they know the bus usually gets there at a certain time.
I agree.
But you're right.
Except now you can track this bus in real time.
You can. Absolutely.
There's not a chance that you'll be out at that bus stop and miss it today. You can track it and you can be there.
Well,
and
actually, that's
not only that, but you could be at the bus stop before.
Yes, you can.
Yep. And I have huge concerns.
Any other questions? Commissioner Van Snow? Wait, just 1 minute. Did you finish your presentation?
Yes,
we kind of jumped into questions.
I just wanted to do a couple quick points to actually touch on.
Commissioner Van Snow, do you want to wait?
That's
and then
fine.
We'll.
Yeah.
I kind of jumped in, sorry.
I just had a couple quick points that I want to navigate to just to show you quickly for more information that you can go look at on a website link, which is in the brochure. Just to show you that website, but I also wanted to point to where the privacy and security rights legal claimers and disclaimers and clauses are. They are on the application and on the website. I know that's been an interest in a number of school districts as far as, you know, the legal protections and stuff. So let me just point to that real quick, and then we can go right into any further questions.
Thank you.
So on the application or on the website, as I said, there is going to be a privacy policy, which is going to have all the disclaimers regarding personal information, what we may collect, special notes for parents, legal guardians. This is pretty lengthy, but certainly it's available. You can go look to it and read through it. I'm sure maybe the district's attorneys or representations want to review it. There's also in the application or on the websites, you know, terms of use and you know, just kind of outlining, again, more legal disclaimers and information that will be helpful as far as privacy and unlawful prohibited use, et cetera. And then one last thing I'll point to on the actual application is there's FAQs. Actually, it's on the website piece. So I'll click back over to the website, which is actually in your brochure. There's a link to it that's going to take you to information, how it works, some FAQ documents. It'll show you the web browser, how it flows, and
you know, some good setup information. It's a pretty helpful website link, so I suggest, you know, if you want to get a little bit more information, you can dig in there. There's also, I think, some information from other school districts using it. So there's some good info on there. That's really kind of what I wanted to point to today, tonight, and then kind of really open it up for further questions and dialogue.
Thank you. Commissioner Vanstone?
Thank you, Madam President, through you. The how-to and all online is great. For those of us who are grandparents sometime waiting for the bus, we need a little more dumbed-down version. So what, and we do have a lot of grandparents. The millennium parents do just fine. They'll figure this out and probably know more about it than you. But what else will we send home besides just a brochure for our parents to make sure they're aware and how to use this?
We'll send home an entire package, Commissioner. It won't be just the brochure, because you're right. I'm not a millennial, and I would have trouble with this. Probably a grandchild of about 7 or 8 could hack into it and run the whole thing by themselves. But we met today as a group. We'll continue to meet. We meet once a week with Mr. Hunter and Ms. Pratt, and we will come up with an entire package to make it step-by-step, hopefully easy for anyone such as me. If I can do it, most people can do it. It won't be just this brochure, just this pamphlet.
Was that a shot at me?
No, sir. I'm older than you. No, I shoot at myself.
That's good. And because if we do, and I hope, certainly hope we enact this, I would assume it'll go live as quickly as we get the administrative stuff out of the way.
Yes.
And then hopefully then the years to follow, we just include at the beginning of the year, here's what we're about. Now, the website when you did it, or the app when you did it, included the bus ID. That's obviously, being that it was about 5 digits, is different than the actual bus number you see drive by your house.
Right.
And I'll speak for grandparents. Are you going to be able any way to relate that 5 or 6 digit number to the number 3 that's on the side of the bus that I'm really outside looking for?
Yeah, that's a great point. As we look to administratively launch and go live, that's some of the cleanup that we can do. We can change from an asset number to more of a local route ID. We just would have to change that in our system. But yes, the short answer, we could make it be bus 3 or bus 40.
Okay, I like that, because I am only home at the time my grandparents do get dropped off once or twice a week at my house, occasionally.
That's true.
And if my wife's not there, I sit outside sweating bullets that I missed the bus. So I think the app's going to be good once I figured out how to use it. I think it's a very good thing. I think as far as security, I understand what Commissioner Sweeney's saying, but we could probably have that conversation about everything we do in this day of age, unfortunately. So I like the idea. Commissioner Harvey brought this to us a few meetings ago, mm-hmm. to think about this, and I think it's fantastic. Hopefully it works out. And I think the parents will grasp it fine, but we do have a lot of grandparents that do have to be at the bus stop. So we need to make sure everyone understands how to use it. Last question. We have city buses that are not necessarily public schools that are on the roads, right? We service various different parochial, we service aftercare programs, yes. We service a number of things that are not traditional start of school, end of school, correct?
Correct.
Will those parents also be able to utilize this app?
Yes, they will.
And how will we do that? Because are we now attaching student ID numbers to non-public school students?
That's a good question. We need to get you a good answer.
All right, because once this app is out there, I will guarantee you, you're going to get a call, Jeff, from a Catholic school or parochial school parent that is going to say, how do I track my bus? So
sure.
We really need to give that some consideration. I'm assuming the same software, hardware, whatever is on the bus, is on any bus regardless of what school is going to. So those parents are going to have that expectation just like the public school student parent does. So make sure we take a look at that, okay?
One point I need to make. This is Durham proprietary software. This is not All-Star. This is not the early childhood ed buses. This is Durham.
Only the Durham buses.
So if someone on an All-Star bus, it will not be available.
We need
we
to make that clear also then,
we need
right?
To check.
Yes.
We need to make clear to a parent that if your child has, I'll say, alternate transportation,
right.
that this may or will not be available to them. Whether those companies offer it, we have to, I guess, explore that. But as far as what we're talking about tonight, we need to make sure parents understand that if they're on alternate transportation.
Correct.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam President.
Okay. Commissioner Stengel.
Thank you.
And then Commissioner Hart.
Thank you. Just to recap again on the access of who can get access to this app for a particular child. I know as if I was a parent, I would, mother, father, grandfather, grandmother, aunt, cousin, uncle, babysitter.
The access will be open to anyone with the right login, password, and email account. If you share your email account with someone else, you share your password as we do with other systems, they'll have access to it.
So we have no control, or the bus company has no control of how a parent who has this code access can pass it out to anyone else.
That's correct. The bus company won't know that I've given my login to Mr. Hunter and he's using that to pick up my children at the bus stop. Mm-hmm. It will show that I'm the custodial parent, mm-hmm. and that's it.
Okay.
We don't go into the legality of the child-parent relationship. It's the responsibility of the custodial parent mm-hmm. to either share or not share that information. If they do, then that's their responsibility.
The bus company, or we won't know that. It's up to whatever the parent has done with that information.
Yes, Commissioner.
Okay. All right. My next question is, I'm going to paint a scenario here. I'm a grandfather who's been charged with picking when my grandson gets home to take my grandson to the dentist. Okay, now I'm watching the clock and I'm afraid that it's getting late and the dentist appointment is coming soon. So I look on my app and I say, I can head in that direction and get my son, my grandson, off a bus at a much earlier stop, closer to the dentist. If I do that, and I know where that bus is, am I going to be allowed to take my grandson off the bus? No.
That's a question that's not dependent on this app. That's right. Parents today meet the bus at stops that are not their assigned stop. And the drivers generally release the child at that stop. But again, that's not dependent on having this app at all. It's something that is done today, every day.
Right, and when that's done, does the bus driver allow the child to get off?
Yes, with proper ID.
So if that's done and more people have access to where that bus is going, is that going to slow the process up if all of a sudden we find another parent wants with a proper ID take their son off the bus because they want to go to Froyo, which is closer to that bus stop than it is when they come home?
That's a possibility. Mm-hmm. But again, once people find out about that tonight after this meeting, without worrying about this application, they can do the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So my next question would be, going forward now, Will we, as central office or the bus company, will we have data about how many parents have used this code and how many times, how many codes they gave out? No, because that's going to go to everybody, anyone they want to give it to. Do we have data, will we, on how many parents have requested this app and are using it?
Yes, we will.
Okay. And then will we also keep... Okay, will we also keep data, and I just have a feeling that there's going to be an instance now and then that happens that, well, that wouldn't have happened if we didn't have this app to know where the bus was. Are we going to have data about any issues that may arise because of this app? We will keep that, Mr. Hunter?
Yes, we will.
Okay. Okay, and my last question is, let's suppose that I am a parent and I do not have a smartphone. I have a flip phone. And so I want to call downtown and I say, I like that app. And you're going to say, this is how you do it. And I'm going to say, I have a flip phone. Am I going to be able to get it?
No.
You can utilize the internet, which would be on a local computer or a PC, or even a home tablet if they have that. If they don't have an actual device that can do a smartphone or a PC, then there would be no access.
Okay. So that would be, it's not a convenient thing for parents who have a flip phone and don't have that app. All right. Mr. Hunter, being in, you know, the busing coordinator and all, and you have looked into this from other districts, do you have any information from other districts that there was an issue that they had, that they explained to you, or is it?
No, there haven't been any issues with any of the surrounding towns at all. I've been using it for 7 years now.
Oh, okay.
This tracking device.
Well, right, you do.
There haven't been any issues at all, yeah. Like you said, we're in the beginning stages, and once we get forward, we can work out any kinks we need to work out.
Okay, all right. Well, I do have concerns with it, as I have said, but that's all the questions I have for now. Thank you, Madam President.
Commissioner Harvey.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I appreciate the questions from the commissioners and know that we all have those concerns. First of all, I want to thank you, Jeff, and Mr.
Mr. Schmuck.
Mr. Schmuck, and you, Bob, for looking into this. And I want to give a little history here of why we're here today. All along, parents have asked, have complained about, at times, of not knowing, you know, the bus is late, and we all know why, because we get stuck in traffic, why the bus was late, due to traffic, due to extenuating circumstances, et cetera. And they have asked that to know where the bus is, you know, or when is the bus going to arrive. I experienced that as an auntie waiting for my 5-year-old nephew. His bus was supposed to arrive at 2:15 at his location. It was 2:30, it was 2:40, it was 2:45. Now I'm getting nervous because he's the youngest one in the family. Finally, it arrived at 3 o'clock due to traffic. And we all living in Waterbury know how traffic is. Anything could spur traffic in the city. And it was ironic because this particular incident happened shortly after a child was left in the wrong location. Now, I'm not saying that this would have prevented it, but I said, you know, I really know now what the parents are saying here. We created an ad hoc committee to look at different things. There's about 5 items. One of the items is this app, an app so that parents can kind of know, trace their bus and know pretty much where their student is. Not the student on the bus, but just kind of know if it's this bus number, that pretty much this is where the student is. Basically, to put the parent's mind at ease to know that. And again, I know that. Again, I don't have any kids in the district, but, you know, God has a funny sense of humor. He put me in charge of roughly over 19,000. So I know that. I know that anxiety. Talking with the community, particularly BTS community forum and other parents in the district, hearing that over and over again, we need something to know about where our kids are when the bus is late. So I Googled, you know, different things about what is happening in the state. But I also looked on our website, and I heard concerns about, okay, well, what do we do if this happens? What do we do if that happens? And I would implore the commissioners to look on our website, because we don't have, where's Will? Will, do we have any restrictions as far as access to our Waterbury Public School District website? There are no restrictions, right?
Nope.
Anyone can go on our,
right.
Okay.
Yep.
Listed on our public school website is our schedule with the bus numbers, the time, the stops, the actual street locations, the approximate route, I'm looking at Driggs, when it's supposed to arrive, going to school, when it's supposed to arrive, coming home. Anyone can get access to this. So we obviously will put the parameters in place, the conditions, et cetera, that were raised, we deal with those today. Okay, so I'm just here, I'm just grateful. When our parents speak, our parents usually get the raw end of the stick. They're criticized for not participating, et cetera. But when they speak, we need to listen. And if we can get this in place, this would be a great satisfier to our parents, taking into consideration the parameters, the security, et cetera, absolutely. But this is one step in like five or six items that we need to address with parents. So I applaud Bus Company, Jeff, Bob, for looking into this, and hopefully we can get this in play, monitoring it as we should, making sure our kids' safety is there, but get this app in place for our parents.
Thank you, Madam President.
Okay. Thank you very much. Any other questions? Thank you very much. Oh, Commissioner Sweeney.
I will state again that I would like for some honest historical information on whether or not a child has ever been put at risk because someone was able to track a bus. And I would like some historical information on whether or not there have been issues in districts because parents are pulling students off of a bus at an earlier stop. I'm not convinced. I heard from parents too. I heard from parents who don't want their kids tracked. So there's two sides of the issue. I'm bringing up the other side. I have parents who are concerned.
Madam President.
Thank you.
Madam President.
Commissioner Harvey.
Thank you. I understand those concerns. I have asked parents to come down and speak to the board next week. I'm sure those parents have those concerns as well. But the data that we track is going to be pre-app. And then if you have any data from the state, I don't know if you do, that would be helpful. But again, I believe that looking at all the parameters, looking at all the security members, we should put this app in place. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Next on the agenda is Mr. Shuda. Zuda. I always call him Shuda. Sorry. Just don't call you late for dinner, right? Good evening.
All right. I'm here tonight to talk to you guys about the new student data privacy policy. This is a new policy in response to the state of Connecticut legislation PA 16189. It's an act concerning student data privacy. This policy requires school districts to safeguard student data and keep it secure. It requires that we outline who has access to this data, how it can be used to ensure security mechanisms are in place to protect student data, ensure access to student data is restricted to qualified authorized users only, ensure teachers, other staff members, and service providers are only given access to specific pieces of data that they need to do their job, ensure contracts with service providers who have access to the student data in order to perform their specific function include strict controls to protect student data, maintain controls over any personally identifiable information, comply with all existing federal and state student data privacy laws such as FERPA, which is the Family Educational Rights Privacy Act, and HIPAA. And then we also have a webpage set up right now that provides more information to parents in the community that they can click on from going to our webpage. It has a lot of FAQs up there. And we also have recently uploaded the new PowerSchool contract. The new PowerSchool contract is up there with the memo. Robocall went out last night notifying parents mm-hmm. that we just signed an agreement with PowerSchool, talking to them about the data that's going to be residing in PowerSchool, talks about the security measures that we put in place to protect their student data. And also gives them a copy of the contract so they can review it and look at the parts of the contract that we've included in the recent PowerSchool talk about confidentiality, student data privacy and security breaches and information, informing parents if there's a security breach. Those are all laid out in every contract moving forward. We've incorporated into the PowerSchool. And there's a couple of other ones that are coming out with Edgenuity and these other companies that we will be doing business with, that these clauses are being placed in by Corporation Council, and they're being monitored in Corporation Council. Checks on me to make sure that we did our due diligence, to make sure that we posted them, made the call out to parents, notified parents, and give the parents the option to opt out. That's pretty much it. And you know, so anybody have any questions, I'm more than willing to answer them.
Commissioners, any questions? I just had one question. In terms of, I was under the impression that this was already in place, that we had student privacy law. So is there a big difference in this new policy, or?
Well, we had FERPA for student records, but right now, with, you know, everything going to the cloud, we have, there are safeguards that have been put in place that allows parents to know what information is being stored with what contractor, what vendor.
I see. Okay,
and
so this is
the safeguard,
more...
right? Exactly, the safeguards, gotcha, in place, and the options to opt out, and making sure that they're not selling student data. So, you know, they're not using it for data mining and target advertising. So all those safeguards are placed into this policy now, this public act that came out. So we had to incorporate into all our contracts to ensure that they adhere to those new rules and regulations.
And is there a cost to the district for implementing this?
No. I mean, besides, you know, I mean, time. But, yeah, I mean, but, you know, but now, you know, the cost is moving forward that we have to ensure that this is done and that we adhere to this policy and that we protect student information. So.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Vanstone.
This isn't really specifically to this policy, but I guess to any policies that come through. You know, sitting on the policy committee, I had the opportunity to see the marked up version versus, yeah, this. And usually, and I think all the commissioners would appreciate it if we could, when we go to workshop in the meeting, can we see, you know, the draft versus the new language? Because a lot of times it's easier to lay one over the other. I noticed in the packet tonight, some of them have that and some of them are just the new clean version. But if going forward we could just have, was that, there was no old one for this one?
This, there was no,
yeah, only
prior
thing we,
policy.
Yeah, only thing we removed was the, yeah, the authorized use form in the back.
Yep.
That's the only thing that we removed. But the kind of language followed the PA16189,
mm-hmm,
so we left it alone. It covered everything that we needed to. So they actually came, did a real good job of drafting one and getting one ready for districts.
And is item number 3 brand new as well? I thought they were changed on that one because it's the same.
No, it's brand new as well.
That one's new as well?
Yep.
Well, then the ones I saw markups are deserve markups.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Commissioner Sweeney, student alcohol use, drugs, and tobacco.
Actually,
Mr. Gorman's going to Mr. Gorman's going to do that? Okay. I just see your name here. So.
Oh, okay. Yeah, Joe Gorman's here.
Good evening, Joe.
Good evening, everyone. Just to kind of cut right to the chase with this particular policy, this is a Connecticut Association of Board of Education format policy. Uses primarily all of the language recommended by CABE. And in terms of, there's been a push on for palliative use of medical marijuana. One of the things that happened on Tuesday and all the excitement around other things is that a lot of people don't realize that 4 states made access to legalized marijuana far more easy in 4 states, one of them being Massachusetts, right on our front doorstep. So in light of state regulations requiring us to have a policy to deal with students who are being treated with medical marijuana, this is our answer to that. The primary thing that I would want to have all of you apprised of is that there is nothing that compels the district to allow use of THC during school hours, on school grounds, by students, by adults at any time. My understanding is that there are a few conditions, very rare conditions for seizure disorders and whatnot, that a substance known as a CBD, cannabinoid-based derivative, is what is the active ingredient that helps to calm seizures. It is not THC, which leads to, you know, that quote high that people use marijuana for. So I would like to at least assure you that based on the policy as I saw it and as I recommended to the policy committee, it does not compel opening the doors to any type of widespread use throughout our schools. In fact, has the exact opposite effect of prohibiting that. The only thing that the policy as proposed does is it informs the district that you cannot refuse to enroll a student who is being so treated. But that does not allow the student to either have those treatments administered on school grounds or used in school activities before, during, or after school on school grounds. So I'm sorry I don't have the whole backup document with me this evening, but I can answer whatever questions you may have about it.
I just had one question in terms of a waiver. Mm-hmm. Is there any inclusion of the ability of a parent to seek a waiver if there's a circumstance where that they think that the child does need it mm-hmm. during the school hours?
Mm-hmm. Based upon the language that I have seen in the law, again, it does not compel the district to submit to such a waiver. And the language in the policy as put forth defends against that, quite frankly.
Okay. All right. I think we're going to have to see how this plays out. Because, I can envision it, some parent right. fighting to have, a child. Right. And I could see maybe there should be an option for a waiver right. if it's due. But I think we can start right. off this way and then see how it goes.
If the board wishes to entertain it, fine. But, I would underscore the fact the state makes it very, very specific right. that schools are an exception to having to need to comply with waivers and medical orders on this issue.
Isn't the teachers the certified? Yeah, thank you. Certified, non-certified, that's the same. It's just the same policy for teachers.
Okay. And then if you want to, since you're there. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, Juanita.
My question would be this. Say we do have a student that is allowed to mm-hmm. have medical marijuana usage.
Right.
And this is basically for the board. And that student has that usage before he comes to school. Mm-hmm. He gets to school mm-hmm. and someone smells that mm-hmm. smell on him. Mm-hmm. Is he going to be reprimanded in any way? Will that person, will the school district know who is approved? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Because, they get in school and mm-hmm. someone says, yeah. I smell mm-hmm. such and such on Johnny. Mm-hmm. And then next thing we know, we got our SRO going to get Johnny and
he's arresting,
him. Mm-hmm. So these are mm-hmm. things that we need to make sure come into play
yep.
when...
First, Commissioner Sweeney.
Yeah. Johnny, first of all, first of all, it's approved for medical marijuana in the state of Connecticut is not inhalable. It's not smokable. It's a pill. Mm-hmm. It's a pill. Mm-hmm. That's what's approved for medical marijuana in the state of Connecticut. Yeah, it's a pill. So the policy from the state that the mandate from the state law is very specific about not charging someone with being under the influence if they can produce a medical certificate.
Okay.
That's what this policy is geared toward. That's what this policy answers to.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. And also kind of in line with that, this was discussed at the policy committee meeting, changing the language to the recommended language regarding ingestion rather than smoking or vaporizing or anything like that really covers all bases. And again, school districts are not compelled to have to tolerate any kind of use that leads to the historical perception of what marijuana does to individuals, mm-hmm. okay? And in the case that you cited, if someone comes in and reeks of the smell, district is fully within their rights to discipline in whatever way they see fit because
that's not medical marijuana.
It's not medical marijuana, plain and simple.
Well,
Getting back to the point of ingestion, though, why this is truly important now is because there are numerous products out there that use different ingestible forms. I mean, and actually market them so that they look like other products that kids love, you know, like Pop-Tarts rather than Pop-Tarts and things like that. So that one word makes a big difference in the policy language in terms of being able to keep those elements away.
Will this be... go ahead.
Can I just... Okay, so you're saying that it's not a smokable marijuana. It's a pill.
Medical marijuana.
So is all medical marijuana a pill? No.
No.
Okay. And this is my... This is what I'm saying.
Right. It's a very narrow definition for children.
All medical marijuana, exactly, for children.
Yeah, right.
All medical marijuana is not a pill.
Right.
There is smokable marijuana. Mm-hmm. And if we have a student that has a medical waiver for smokable marijuana, will that child be arrested because he comes to school smelling like marijuana?
In the state of Connecticut, children under the age of 18 cannot be approved for smokable marijuana. They can
and what if we have a student
pill.
That is over the age of 18 that is still going to school that has a release for smokable marijuana?
If they don't bring it onto grounds and they're able to produce a certificate, they don't bring it onto grounds.
I'm
if
not
they
saying
produce they... a certificate and they are not, and if this is in the policy too, they don't create a danger or a safety hazard. That's also in the policy, it's also in the state law. They will not be prosecuted.
Okay, I understand that. Yeah. And I'm not saying that they bring it to school. I'm saying
they smell.
Before I come to school, I hit my smokable medical marijuana, and I happen to go to school, and someone smells it on me, am I going to be arrested?
If you have your certificate.
Which is fine.
Well,
and which
and
is
it's
something
not on
that
you,
the
you're
district,
not carrying.
The district also would be within its rights to tell the student to go home.
As long as all
as well these, as an adult who comes in that
as
way.
As long as all these scenarios are covered when we take this on.
I mean,
state of Connecticut says you got to allow it. So
okay,
it's a mandate.
Would the district be? I mean, as I said at my first question, building on what Commissioner Hernandez is saying, we might want to consider putting language that smelling of marijuana does not constitute smoking marijuana, because you could be in a car with somebody smoking marijuana and smell like it, and you're not the victim. So I think we have to think about it, because I would hate to see somebody come to school just with a smell and get arrested or get expelled for smelling. So I just want to make sure that doesn't happen. I agree.
I think that's an issue beyond medical marijuana. We're talking about medical marijuana. Either they have a certificate or they don't.
Right.
Then it's a whole other issue.
But we need to
the policy is specific to medical marijuana.
Okay. Right. All right. I get you. Okay. Commissioner Vanstone.
I'm going to go out on a limb and say someone walked into one of our schools today smelling like marijuana, and they didn't get arrested. I think we're talking about two separate things.
Yes.
And I think it's a common sense issue. I'm not too sure we can write a common sense policy that includes all the potential things. I think that is something that is handled at the time, the day, by the administrator. If it's an upper grade, you know, they handle it. I don't know if that's a place that, I definitely don't think it's in this policy, but I'm not too sure if that's something that we start articulating, you know, how much does that person smell like marijuana, or maybe it's not marijuana. I don't know if that's our deal here. I think there's enough rules in place for if a child brings in and or may have taken some kind of illicit substance before they got here. I don't think that belongs here, and I think more often than not, common sense would probably prevail in that scenario. And again, if they don't have anything on them, smelling like something's not illegal, so I'm not too sure what they would be charged with anyway.
Okay, that's a good clarification.
My two cents.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Any other questions? Commissioner Harvey?
Yeah, it just, as Commissioner Hernandez was going over and over with your questions, We have dog sniffing, I'm not going to call them raids. And I don't know exactly, I mean, I don't want to expose that, but what exactly the dogs are trained to sniff. If, for example, this situation occurs and someone has to do something before they come to school, maybe it's on their clothes, maybe it's on their knapsack, maybe it's on, and a dog happens to pick that up. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know. That's another scenario.
I'm assuming as long as they can verify their marijuana certificate, that everything is fine. And that was my question. Okay. As long as they can produce it, and they happen to have that smell, right. I don't want kids to be arrested or whatever.
Okay.
Just right. because.
So that extends my next question is, does that mean then that the students who require this are going to have to walk around with their certificate in the school? Does that mean that? I'm asking Joe.
Yeah. To kind of step back away from looking at it that way.
Go ahead.
As I saw the policy language that we're putting forth here today, it was protection to the district from liability of, you know, perhaps confronting a student who is on American medical marijuana plant. And if there's any misuse of that, it protects the district. Now, in terms of dog searches and whatnot, I'm certainly not the authority on that. I'm sure Chief Riddick would be a much better person to bounce that off of. But I know that those examinations were of lockers and kids weren't there. So, I mean, the dogs don't go around sniffing kids. I know they go and they sniff the lockers. And they make sure that the kids are away from the lockers when they do it. So I don't know if that helps answer that question or not. But, I mean, everything that what's being put forward here today is that it recognizes that some very, very small percentage, minute percentage of kids may be prescribed medical marijuana in a totally different form than we're used to, again, because of CBD rather than THC. And what it's saying is the district cannot refuse to enroll a student who is so being treated, but it doesn't mean that the district has to open the gates to any type of behavior related to marijuana.
Okay.
It protects the liability of the district to continue to enforce a healthy and safe environment for all the other 99.897% kids that are in the district. And so from that viewpoint, I think it's very valuable for us to move forward with it, and that's why I recommended we go with it. I don't know if that helps or not, but I mean, these other issues we probably need a separate policy for, or at least guidelines, if not policy. The thing I'm as Commissioner Van Stone said, I mean, you can't have a policy to meet every single
scenario.
Variation of a situation, but if you have, you know, at least a procedure on how to deal with it by level, then you know it gives that latitude to the administrators and the teachers in the building to effectively deal with that and still serve the needs of the child. So,
okay. Commissioner Harvey?
Yes, just, and that's good, Joe. But we're living in a new age, and you know, we're not looking for every scenario to solve, but you know, I the disability I have, I'm eligible for that. I don't do it. You know, I don't really need to disclose that. But I also know there are some teachers who have the same disability that I have, who may have to take it. And that's why I was questioning: Does this also apply to the teachers?
For personnel, once again,
we have another policy.
The district does not have to accept someone medicating themselves during work hours, in the work environment, on school grounds, before school, after school program, evening, athletic event. You're fully within your rights as a board to prohibit that self-medication activity. And it gives you the option to do that. And personally, I don't see any other common sense way for the district to proceed than that way. I really don't.
Thank Commissioner Thurio.
My question really isn't to you, Joe. It's more rhetorical. Now that Massachusetts has passed marijuana for recreational use, the other shoe eventually may drop here.
Yes.
I think it's a matter of time.
This policy will have to be, if not entirely rewritten, a good portion of it will.
I would certainly hope not. To be honest with you, I have really gone over an awful lot of data coming out of Colorado now that it's been about 4 or 5 years. And there are some very significant issues of concern about school performance in Colorado now that is directly tied to opening the gates to recreational use of marijuana in Colorado. And, you know, whether or not that we would be bound to repeat what's going on there, but it's some pretty scary statistics.
Commissioner Sweeney.
I think that in most cases with young children that parents know that it's in the child's best interest to, you know, inform the nurse of any medications that a child is taking. And I think that, that would more than likely happen on a voluntary basis for anyone in this situation. And in terms of staff, up next is the staff policy. We do have a step of policy for staff that applies pretty similar language. It just simply says you can't bring it onto grounds. If you have to ingest it, if you have to smoke it, it has to be done off of grounds. And if you're under the influence, then we can make a decision as to whether or not it creates a safety issue. And then the school has the right to say, you know what, you're not capable of being here today under the influence. Or to say, we know you're under the influence, but everything is fair and common, and you have the licensing, the correct licensing for it, and therefore it's okay that you're under the influence. So, you know, it's...
This also extends to school buses, too. We didn't talk about that. I know it was an issue earlier with school buses.
Yep. So that applies to all staff.
All right. Good.
We do have a separate policy for staff.
Okay. Commissioner Vanstone.
Very quickly. We established policy. The superintendent or staff established procedure. So I think if we do that, everything will take care of itself.
Commissioner Harvey, did you have a comment?
Yeah, I'm just going to say I think it's good to bounce this around and just make sure that we understand, because there are concerns. But I hate to tell you, Joe, but I just heard on the radio that Governor Malloy is considering, in light of what happened in Massachusetts, considering what needs to be done here in Connecticut. So I just thought I'd pass that along. That was as of 3 o'clock this afternoon.
Well, in one respect, and not to get too deeply into the issue, but in one respect, I find it incredibly ironic that on the national level we're spending so much time being focused on opioid addiction when, as someone who has worked in prevention all his life, knows that the gateway to those things are precisely the things we're talking about now. Alcohol, tobacco, and marijuana are the gateways to the others. So it's just incredibly ironic that we seem to be going in two different directions at once with that. And my recommendation is, if we can slow it down for the kids here in Waterbury, any way we can do that, I'm for it. I'm sorry that makes me old school, but I'm for it.
Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. Commissioner Sweeney, number 5, request approval of revisions to the bylaws.
Yep. So Commissioner Harvey had come forward and requested that we take a look at our meeting night. When Commissioner Harvey and myself and Commissioner Stengel came to the board, our meeting night was on Monday. It was changed actually midway through our term at one point to Thursday night. There was some discussion about going back to the Monday night. There are, at this point, we are at that same juncture where we have commissioners who have come to the board, who have run for election, and who have accepted the charge, knowing that they would be giving up Thursday nights. And I am now, myself, quite frankly, I like the Monday because I had that time all weekend. I work all week, so I had time all weekend to go through my packet. don't have that time now, and now I kind of cram it in on Tuesday nights and Wednesday nights after work. So as much as I like that, I also don't like the idea that we may severely inconvenience some commissioners who have committed their life and built it around that Thursday night meeting to now have to find a way to readjust for a Monday night. So the suggestion that came forth out of the committee was that we reduce our meetings to one workshop a month and one regular voting meeting per month, and that that voting meeting be on the third Thursday, and that our committee workshop, similar to tonight, would be on the first Thursday of each month. So you would have a week in between to go over everything that you were presented at workshop. We would have more time to do our work in committees and then bring it to the board and make our decisions from there. We would reduce our meetings. I spoke with Dr. Ouellette, who spoke with staff, to advise them that this was something that we were looking at. Would they be able to accommodate that shortened schedule? Because certainly we don't want to be throwing things on the agenda at the last minute or finding ourselves in a bunch of special meetings because something needs to be addressed today. I was reassured that staff could handle that, that they could work with that, and that would give them two free Thursday nights a month, as it would us. So that is the proposal that has come forth, to move our meeting night to the third Thursday per month. And that's it.
Any questions, comments? Commissioner Van Stone.
Thank you, Madam President. Sure, I'm for this because I've always been one that has said we should do more in committee and bring more committee decisions to the floor as opposed to always just discussing an open forum. However, I also admit I signed up when I was running and then elected to four Thursdays. I'm not looking at this as having 2 days off. Right. I'm saying that we need to understand that maybe it's not a Thursday, maybe it's a Tuesday, maybe it's a Wednesday, maybe it's a Monday, a Friday.
No Friday.
We still have, I don't care what day it is. I signed up for the days I did. And I don't want to do this because we don't want to meet four times a week. That's not the reason we're doing this. We only do this if the committees will take this serious and do their work in committee and bring the proper attention to things before we vote. I'm not looking for two Thursdays off. I'm looking to get our work done. We signed up for it. We knew what we were getting ourselves into. So to just say we're doing it to get Thursdays off is not the right way to advertise this. This has to mean committees mean business. Because right now committee meetings are haphazard. All right? There's no shrug to that, Madam President. They're haphazard. We get short notice. Sometime we're going to have a complete agenda. I attend committee meetings I don't belong to. I've missed one committee meeting my entire time on this board that I was scheduled to be at. That's our job. We signed up for it. So I don't want this to be just something to limit our calendar. If we're not going to do this right, I'm not going to vote for it. So I better be assured, and if it doesn't work out, I'll be looking to change it back. So thank you.
Commissioner Stengel, then Commissioner Van Stone, Commissioner Harvey.
Thank you, President Brown. I also support this. And I hear Commissioner Tom Van Stone, and he's right to a certain extent. We're not looking to reduce our meetings. In a sense, some of us may not be reducing our meetings. We will be having committee meetings. So as a committee member, your committee may be meeting on that alternate Thursday night, maybe for more than one committee. So I wouldn't look forward to having that middle Thursday night off consistently. Your committee may not meet that night. You may decide to come anyway, and I hear what you're saying because I do the same thing. However, it's not the point of and I agree with you, of reducing our attendance at meetings. It's just in a different form of meetings. And on the other side of the coin, our attendance as a board, for two reasons, in two instances, have been slacking off, in the sense that some of us, you might be reaching meeting burnout, in the sense that it's constant, constant, constant. So when we have a committee meeting scheduled for that alternate Thursday, you're going to be more open and be able to attend to it. We've been heading, I feel this board has been heading toward the committee format, the committee model, in the last 3-4 years, more than we have in the past. Way back in the past, we very seldom had a committee. Everything was meeting on the workshop schedule, which we called committee meetings. But in a sense, we still have to delve deeper into the committees. So I think that's a good way to go. Doing that model of committees, and then being true to that committee. And as Commissioner Van Stone says, that we have short notice, and that is because, in reality, when it's put out to the committee, can you make this night? Can you make this night? Oftentimes, it's on a Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday, or the time is not right, and you can't make that night. So you beg off of it. So then you have to find another night. So meantime, the clock is ticking, and we have to put together that committee at the final moment, because we need to have the committee meet for something that's coming up. So I think we've been working toward that, and I think that when we do this new model, I believe that attendance will improve, and it will be easier to schedule the meeting in the long run. So, and the other thing I wanted to say is that when you look at the design of the meeting, we look at the design of our workshop. The workshop consists of, I think, in three things. It consists of action items. And action items are items that we have to come forward next week to vote on. For example, tonight we're going to talk about some contracts. We talked about some policies. These are action items. They're going to have to be voted on. So that's one aspect of a committee meeting, of the workshop meeting. The other aspect of the workshop meeting are legal information that we talk about, in a sense that we have to post officially school usage. We have to post field trips that are being granted and being where they're going. And we have to post the superintendent notification, where she talks about hires, and we talk about resignations, talk about transfers. These things also are on a workshop. So when we do a workshop, and the other thing we have to do in a workshop is many times is informational presentations. This can be done at a regular meeting. My vision is a workshop consists of action items that have to come up for a vote. Mm-hmm. And the other legal things, which we tend to most of the time skim by quickly. Mm-hmm. Now, what about the big major presentations that we get from ILDs, we get from the chief academic officer, we get from the superintendent? That takes a lot of time at a workshop. And I say that we don't have to do that at a workshop. We can do that at a regular meeting. Regular meeting, we go through the action items we had to, and we say, okay, tonight's regular meeting, we're also going to have a presentation from the chief academic officer and the superintendent. We don't have to vote on this. It's just an informational. It takes it off of the major workshop night, and it puts it in a meeting night, which tend to be shorter. So having said all that, I think in the long run it's going to be better when we'll have more time to schedule these committee meetings in plenty of advance notice, so that you can make a plan to attend and then move to the regular meeting on the alternate Thursday. So I think we're going to work as hard and as much. It's just not in the official capacity of a Thursday night major workshop. There'll be individual little committees, possibly, on that Thursday, since we're used to that in our mind and body. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Stango. Commissioner Van Stone.
Thank you, Madam President, through you. As one of the people, even though I was neglected to be mentioned by Commissioner Sweeney, who started on Monday nights, I too liked it
forgot.
Better. Yeah, you forgot.
I'm
Thanks.
Sorry.
Appreciate that.
Oh, God.
And it was a lot easier. And I liked it. And I fought the change to Thursday, but then it happened. But I'm one of those people who now has set up their life in a certain way where I can't just simply go back to Mondays. But the reason we got here originally for some history, and I think Commissioner Harvey is correct, is it seems that if there's any type of event community-related in this town, it tends to happen on Thursday nights, and we miss them all. So if we were to go to this staggered agenda, we'd at least have a 50-50 shot of it not being on a Thursday where we were scheduled to meet regularly. I've been pushing for this committee thing almost since I came on the board, because I think, in all honesty, if we did this correctly, we'd get a lot more work done in committee. And by rearranging the schedule to do this setup as described by Commissioner Sweeney, I think we could actually affect that change. The way we do it now is incredibly inefficient. I'm not too sure if we could pick a more inefficient way to do it. Mm. We talk about it in policy, or we pick them in any committee. We sit there for 2 hours and talk about it, and then we advance it to here, where we talk about it for two more hours. And generally, a lot of us say the exact same thing we said in the company. You know, we could just run the tape. Mm-hmm. And then what do? We come back the next week, and we do it all again and vote on it. Imagine if we saved some of that time and actually did more productive stuff. I imagine a version where we could do that under this committee setup. A second problem we now currently have with committees that makes them ineffective is we're always on the clock. We have a Thursday regular meeting at 6:30, so we try to jam four committee meetings between 5:30 and 6:30, and inevitably, whatever the thing is, and I'll just use myself as an example, that I want to talk about is fourth on the agenda, so we get the, we got another committee meeting in 4 minutes, can we be quick? That's not right or wrong. No, no one's doing it on purpose, but we always put unnecessary deadlines on ourselves. Mm-hmm. Where if we just had, if it's one of those open Thursdays or a Wednesday on that given week, we don't have that gun to our head. We can flesh out any idea we want to. And who knows, maybe in that extra time we come up with an even better idea. But we're not putting ourselves on the clock for no particular reason. I understand the perception of, oh, geez, the board gave itself a 50% break in time. I think if we do this right, we're actually going to find out we're spending a lot more time, not necessarily in this room, but the superintendent's conference room, at one of the areas. I think if we are all committed, and I see no reason why we wouldn't be, to make this work, it won't be every Thursday, but at the end of the day, we'll tally up our hours and we'll have spent more time here doing the business of the city, and I think that's what we should do. And I don't recall if you said this, but it's my understanding that if we agreed to do this, it would be effective coming back from the winter break.
We had discussed January 1st.
So I think, to recap, I think it solves some of Commissioner Harvey's and all of our problems, where at least now we have a chance to maybe go to one of these things that are usually on Thursday nights. Plus, and I would say more importantly, probably do a little better job. And if nothing else, a more efficient job. And I think we, you know, owe that to the people who elected to us. And if we can spend the same time, or probably more, but get 150% more stuff done, I think that's a win-win. Thank you, Madam President.
Thank you. Commissioner Harvey.
Thank you. I think I'm going to start. What? Am I not next? Or is
no,
it?
No, yeah.
Okay. I want to talk about committees. That what seems to be driving this, because beginning of this year, beginning of my term, my third term, I was removed from different committees. If you're a committee member, you have voting rights on that committee, which means that you can vote to move something ahead or move or vote against it, however you want to do that. If anyone wants to analyze and see how, if there's any balance in different board members and on committees, all you need to do is look at the list. There is an imbalance there. I have been on certain committees. I was taken off of it. So if we want to lean towards working more towards our committees, I'm for that, but we got to work out the way that we select members for different committee members. There are different committee commissioners who are in charge of different committees, chairpersons of three or four committees, and then there are those who are not. I'm one of them, for whatever reason. So don't get me started talking about these committees and working towards this board working. Yes, we should be working towards our committees, but it's not selected fairly. So I don't even want to talk about moving towards working on committees. I attend committees where some of the members aren't even there. We can't even have a committee meeting because the members aren't there. You don't have a quorum, i.e. the building committee, talking about the cracks in the floor in Reed School. So don't talk to me about, oh yeah, we need to go to committees. All right, now that I got that off of my chest. Working the agenda, if we work towards meeting agendas, we need to pinpoint the times of different, we have presentations, not knocking anyone. We got 8 people doing one presentation. It only takes 2 or 3 people to do a presentation. That adds more time to the meeting. So let's be efficient with that. If we put the time on the agenda, if it's 10 minutes, it's 10 minutes. You know, adjust the presentation accordingly. Let's talk about attendance from someone who has perfect attendance, okay, regular meeting and the workshops. I've been to just about every one. I think I've only missed 1 or 2 in 11 years. Yeah, we need some more attendance. We need, listen, when I ran for this, I'm on my third term. When I ran for this board, I knew I was going to have to give up, sacrifice things. I want, there are meetings that I want to go to in the community. Hopefully, this schedule will allow us to do that. But if it's going to mean that we are not going to be addressing issues that we need to address, then I'm not for that. I feel there are things that we need to address that we haven't addressed. That's why I've asked for a to-do list. There's things that we haven't even addressed. Commissioner Tom Van Stone has asked for us to look at our pricing that we use to charge for the use of our schools. That's still on the table. We haven't even looked at that. That's been a couple of years from now. We haven't even looked at that. So we need to be more efficient there. Bylaws. We're supposed to look at our bylaws every year, but we wait, and we wait. This request was made, I believe, 2 years ago. Why don't we change back from Thursdays to Mondays? We originally changed it because we wanted to see if we could attend the Board of Aldermen meeting, and we wanted the aldermen to attend our meetings. Well, obviously that didn't work out. Okay, so now we want to change it back. I thoroughly understand, Commissioner Jason Van Stone, that yes, you've adjusted your life. I understand that. But I would hope that this board would hopefully, eventually, return back to a Monday night meeting, because I don't see any reason why I shouldn't. All right, so let's make the adjustments. And originally, when this request was made, it was hopefully to go into effect for the next school year. Okay, but we kind of hemmed and hawed. We didn't do anything during the summer and all that, so we didn't get to that. But I'm okay with doing this for next year. But I would hope that we will continue to see if we can move this back to hopefully a Monday or a Tuesday earlier in the week. Thank you, Madam President.
Commissioner Theriot.
First of all, I agree with Commissioner Harvey's comments with regard to various appointments on various committees. There should be more of a balance. And if there is a rationale for putting someone on and putting someone off, it should be clear and apparent, transparent. Obviously, yours was a political vendetta.
Obviously.
You didn't say that. You were too kind.
Thank you.
That being said, I don't believe that we changed our meetings. I was one of the people who for 8 years was on the Monday meetings. And I don't believe we really changed our meetings from Monday to Thursday because we wanted the board to be more effective. It was actually requested by the mayor. So he could attend both meetings. And he was caught up in the Board of Aldermen, wanted to attend the Board of Education, and he said when he got elected, he would attend more and more of the Board of Education meetings, which unfortunately hasn't happened. Maybe not through his own fault because I don't believe he realized the enormity of the position and the enormous time that it takes to be mayor. So that being said, I was thinking more, unfortunately, of a Tuesday or even back to Monday. But are we saying with this change that we're only going to have one Board of Ed official meeting a month?
Yes.
Correct.
And one workshop.
I really can't fathom getting all of that enormous amount of data and contracts, presentations, and all that other stuff that we do with regard to our workshops and getting it all done in one meeting. What's going to happen? There's going to have to be a special meeting a month, probably every other month, because you're going to have, and that one meeting will be a long meeting. It'll be like our old meetings if we're going to put people at the table again and let them do a presentation that night. It will completely dilute the whole concept of the consent calendar. And I was in favor of the consent calendar from the standpoint, I just wanted each of the items read. And that worked out okay. I don't know if the Board of Aldermen still read the items in the consent calendar, but before, they didn't. They just passed the consent calendar without reading them. At least we read them into the record. So I'm opposed to this because I think it's genuinely intended to be more effective with regard to the board's time and efficiency. But I don't think in reality that's really what it's going to come down to. I don't see. You can split the pie whatever way you want, but the amount of time that it takes for the people to do the presentations, and I kind of disagree on some of the topics that come up that are going to be 5 minutes and they end up to be 20 minutes. Absolutely. And maybe, such as this topic on the busing, and the apt, maybe that's as it should be. Maybe not. Maybe we should just say 5 minutes, bzz, buzzers up, you're done. Next group of people. But then we don't get the clarity of what this particular topic is all about. And we don't get the clarity from the board members in terms of their passion and concerns for this particular topic. So I'm not opting for shortening the presentations if other board members are concerned. So, in summary, I play cards on Monday, I play cribbage at the Elks on Monday, so it's convenient for me. And I always wanted to play cribbage, and I never could because I had the Board of Ed, but I made the sacrifice, right? But now when you change to Thursday, I said, oh, now I can play cribbage. If I had to go back to not playing cribbage, it would be all right. But I don't see with the monumental amount of work and presentations and data that we have that we're going to get by with one workshop and one board meeting month. To me, it's not going to happen. I mean, I haven't been on the board as long as you, Commissioner Harvey, but I've been around the block here too with 32 years, and this is my ninth year on the board. I just don't think it's feasible. So when it comes up for a vote and so forth, I'm just going to vote against it. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments? Commissioner Stango?
Thanks, President Harvey. President Brown.
Whoever I am.
That's next year.
I think Commissioner Theriault is correct. You're going to see a special meeting occasionally. That's bound to happen. We have to have a special meeting now when we meet every other week with a regular meeting. But it's going to take a lot of agenda planning work. And I think that we can try that. I think it will be an improved. Now, when we talk about our presentations, and that's what makes a workshop as long as it is. We know that our regular board meetings start at 6:30, and pretty much by 7:15, we're wrapped up most of the time. So we can have a presentation following that and still be done by 8 o'clock if we're talking about time. When we talk about past in the old days, we'd have presentations that went on, and every commissioner felt they had to respond to it and ask a question and ask a meaningful question. And that drags it out. People who keep talking about an item and then bring in historical stuff, I should talk about it, that makes it dragged out. So hopefully, when we have a presentation at a board meeting, the board meeting is short, regular meeting, and we'll have the presentation, so we'll get that out of the way. But our workshops need to be, number one, action items that we need to vote on. And then the rest, a lot of that stuff comes to committee. And again, I'm going to sound maybe a little crazy here. However, I think you'll see that if we have committee meetings and if all things, no disrespect to the cameraman, if there's not a camera there, that committee meeting will go faster. I'll put that down, I'll write it down, and you'll see that it happens. It will go faster.
I'll bring a camera.
But we'll see. But I'm willing to give it a try. Thank you. President Brown.
All right. Commissioner Pagano.
So what was the feeling, part of my voice, it's still not getting there. What was the feeling about not doing Monday nights?
That a number of commissioners have life commitments on Monday nights, and that
so
when they ran for office, they ran for office knowing that they were going to be committed
boat.
On Thursday.
I teach on Monday nights, and I'm committed for the next 3 years.
Yeah, and
contract.
And when you ran for office, you were committed for 4 years on a Thursday night. So, and
but,
I've been through that, having been through that upheaval myself, and Commissioner Vanstone, and
but let me just
Stango,
play devil's
Commissioner
advocate
Harvey,
here.
We know what it's like.
But let's play devil's advocate here. To quote a famous Vulcan philosopher: "The needs of the many far outweigh the needs of the few." Commander Spock.
That's right.
It's in the reality of the equation. That's is right. That the majority would prefer doing Monday nights? Or am I under a false assumption?
Yeah, the
I don't think we've ever taken a vote on
okay.
it.
Yeah.
Well, what came out
the
of
tone
committee
of the committee was,
this, was
Thursdays.
That was an option in committee. What came out of committee was this answer.
Who was in committee?
I was there, but I'm not on the I'm on the committee. I'm on
you're
the,
on the committee.
That's
you
one
were
committee
there.
I'm on, yes.
Passed unanimously. It passed unanimously.
Okay.
President
Commissioner
Brown,
Harvey.
May I? You know, I see a couple of things here. I know we talked about this in committee, that we go to every other Thursday instead of changing it back to Monday.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I'm hearing some opposition on that, and this is a bylaw change, folks. Understand that. So I too am concerned though about making sure we get our work done. That's what I Commissioner Brown, President Brown, I'm concerned about that, because we meet every Thursday and we still have things that we have not addressed. So I'm concerned about that, and I don't want us to fall behind. So now I'm having some misgivings about a regular meeting once a month, and then the committee. So I'm having some misgivings now, because I don't want this board to fall behind on their work. So that's, just thought I'd interject that.
Okay. All right, good discussion. Next on the agenda is request approval of a memorandum of understanding with the United Way of Greater Waterbury. Elaine Skoronsky. So she is number 6 and 7. And do we have executive coffee?
Some tea.
You do? Thank you.
Be careful of those wires. Don't trip those wires, please.
Could you ask? I don't have it here.
Thank you.
Yeah, we have it on here.
Where are you?
Yeah, I don't need this. Oh, Terry.
Okay, it is.
Please make it short.
Good evening, Commissioners. Elaine Skoronsky from the Special Services Department. I passed out another agreement, which differs only insofar as it adds the mayor's signature line. When we first did this and it was sent over to you, legal did not feel it needed a signature line for the mayor, but they changed their mind and sent me a new agreement today. So that's what you have before you, and it's the only way it differs. This program is a United Way program, which is excellent. We seek your permission to bring the program into our schools with respect to our pregnant and parenting teens program, which we have in all of our high schools, and that program is for our pregnant and parenting teens. This program goes so well with it in that it allows the students and their families to be trained in the Born Learning program, which is a very simple but research-based and effective program to teach those parents how to work with their children in a more effective way. It's free. United Way paid for it. Joe Gorman and I work both on the Support for Pregnant and Parenting Teens grant. We're going to give a very small amount of money for beverages for the sessions. There's 6 sessions, and we were hoping to have 2 programs of 6 sessions each, one to start soon, if you approve, and then another one to start again next in 2017, so that we can get up to 20 students and their families trained in the Born Learning Academy program. Thank you.
I just want to say I'm very familiar with the program. It's a great program. We did a pilot last year at Wilson Family Resource Center. I went to the graduation. It was phenomenal. The parents were there with the kids, and, you know, it was really a really great program. I wish we could do more of it, so thank you. Any other questions? I think you're up next, too.
Yes. Elaine Skoronsky, Department of Special Services. This is the yearly agreement with the Waterbury Youth Service Systems. This agreement sets forth the truancy procedures that we use Waterbury Youth Service Systems for. Just as by way of background, there's a state law that requires that the City of Waterbury match the Youth Service Bureau's grant from the state. So depending on what they get from the state, the city has to match their grant. This agreement came about as using part of that money for our purposes for our truancy program, because also under law, we have to send our students for community services. And so therefore, Waterbury Youth Service acts as our community agency that we can send our students to. And they, in addition, send our students out for further community services so that we're able to serve even more students. Now, I know that you like data. I did not get the data today. I'm happy to pass, if you don't mind, I'll get it to you as soon as I can get it from Waterbury Youth. But I will say that we've been happy with their performance over these years. Mm-hmm. The city has to match their grant anyway. They have taken more and more referrals. If you remember the numbers last year, their referrals went up by 100 each year. Mm-hmm. So we're really sending them a lot of kids. And I do work with them to get them to do more and more with their limited resources. Now, for the Waterbury Youth Service contract, most of it is paid in cash. However, about $5,000 is an in-kind contribution from our school system in that Jackie Davis, who we've hired in our schools, will contribute some of her time and that amount of money to assist the Waterbury Youth Service program in the truancy area to make it even more effective. So if you recall last year, the in-kind contribution was the use of two school readiness classrooms. But unfortunately, that's not the case this year. In addition, the Waterbury Youth Service grant did go down. If you recall, we were closer to 100 last year. It's now 80. Mm-hmm. So the match was smaller. Right. Are there any questions?
Commissioner Pagano.
The letter memorandum of understanding doesn't have the mayor's signature on this one. Are we going to get another one with the mayor's signature on?
Yeah, he hasn't signed yet, but there's a line for his signature.
I don't know what I'm looking at. I see. Is this the one we're talking about, or is it the one electronic?
It's the board line. Yeah, I have
a
signature.
I saw that.
The one I just passed out has the mayor's signature on the third, on the fourth page.
The one that I'm looking at.
This is born learning, though.
Yeah, the one you handed out was the last agenda. It's on the iPad. This agenda.
Which item are we talking about? The born learning?
No.
Born Learning Academy program.
Yeah, that's we're talking Waterbury Youth Services. That was the last item.
We're on 5-7.
No, page four. It's on page four.
I got that one. I'm talking about the electronic one I have.
The electronic one is wrong.
Okay, that's why I want to double check.
That's why I passed this out.
Okay, all right.
We didn't have that signature line at the beginning.
Oops.
Hey, I'm looking at it.
Commissioner Vanstone.
Definitely, and I'll get it to you as soon as I possibly can. I apologize for not having it today.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Commissioner Theriot.
Yeah, Elaine, you've always done a good job there at Special mm-hmm. Services. And this is one area that I've always been, you know, a hot spot for me with regard to truancy and the data that I look at every year and the our absenteeism, which in some cases is legitimate, in some cases is part of our truancy problem. So the truancy problem permeates right down, I hate to say it again, to our test scores and the successful education at the high school, middle schools, and elementary schools. But in particular, our high school students are the ones that we have to really go after in terms of youth services and these preventative programs, actually programs that not only prevent absenteeism, but encourage attendance. So
absolutely,
anything that you and Special Services Department can do, excuse me, to improve attendance in any way, shape, or form, you can take it to the bank for me because I'm all for it. Because I see the data out there, I follow the data stringently. I don't let anybody talk me out of it because what is fact, and what is conjecture. You know, we can improve, we can do that, we can do that. Well, when I see improvement with programs like this, if you can get this from 80 to 200 kids, I mean, and the matching grant portion that we have to pay, we seem to take money out of the Alliance grant for everything else. Let's take it out of there for this. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Elaine, I just had a question. I know last year the legislature passed actually doing away with truancy and family with service needs, and mm-hmm. it was a significant change in policy. And I wonder if you've seen any impact on what's going on in the school system for the kids, because we don't have that tool anymore of truancy as part of family with service needs. So at least we had some recourse, but now it's just really up to the school to work with the parents. So I'm wondering if you see a significant impact or any changes.
Well, the law goes into effect next year.
Oh, okay.
So we have a year.
Okay.
I do think it will change what we do with Waterbury Youth Service, because at the current time, we have the contract set up that we want them to get back to us with the results of their work within, I believe it's 20 days from referral. Given the new legislation and the fact that we're really not going to have any place to send these students, mm-hmm. we may want to work, you know, with Waterbury Youth to have them keep our students longer and work with them in a different way. Because of that, we won't have the court option. So it's a great question, and we're going to have to do a little more thinking on that.
Right.
But frankly, over the last 5 years, they haven't been taking many family with service needs anyway.
Because they didn't have the capacity?
They didn't. Been pretty much, rejecting them. So mm-hmm. it was hard to get their help anyway.
Oh, okay.
So I think that this will be a good way for us to work with Waterbury Youth in terms of what they can do long term. And they are making more referrals for us from them to other agencies in the community, which is really good. The more agencies we can get to help with the problems, mm-hmm. the better. And we are working very hard with community agencies. Mm-hmm. I know all of our administrators are working. Our numbers are better than any big city. We have the lowest numbers in New Haven, Bridgeport, mm-hmm. Hartford.
That's good.
Our chronic absent rate's coming down. I mean, we're doing as well as can be expected, I think, for a big city. But we're going to make it even better.
Good. Great. Commissioner Sweeney.
I just want to clarify something that you just said. It's not Waterbury Youth Services that's been rejecting the students. It's the courts for the prisons have been rejecting
right, that's
the
what
attendance.
I meant.
Okay.
Yeah,
I just
I'm
want
sorry,
to make sure we're sure. It's not the referrals to Waterbury Youth Services.
No.
It was the referral to the courts, and the courts have been turning away the attendance. And
truancy.
You're right, for about the last 4 or 5 years, they've been refusing to take the cases.
That's right.
Yeah, okay.
And
I just wanted to make that clear.
The new legislation won't even allow parents to use that.
Yeah.
Many times parents wanted to refer their own students, but they won't be able to do it either.
Right, right. And they lose all that getting into the court system and the supports that are there. That
they had the family support center
that
they
can't
provided
afford
service.
Those out-of-pocket expenses. If they go through the courts, then those expenses are covered. Right. A lot of the parents are going to lose that ability to do that.
So I would be very interested.
Really sad.
Yeah. No, I think you're right. I think this is a significant issue, and I'd like to, maybe have a meeting about it to see where we are and maybe look ahead to what we can do in terms of prevention and what resources we may have to reallocate to this, in terms of priorities as a district. So I think it's a significant issue. So I thank you for being on top of it, but I do think we need a deeper discussion about it.
No, I'm happy to be involved with
thank
that
you.
If you need me.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, thanks, I Lord. Think Mr. Brenker, number 8, oops. Request approval of a license and purchase agreement with Ingenuity to provide student online products and services.
Thank you, Commissioner. Thank you, Madam President. This is a renewal of the contract that we currently use with Ingenuity for the current year, for 1 year.
Did all the commissioners have a chance to look at the contract? Any questions? I think it's pretty pro forma. I did. Mr. Strand was not able to be here tonight. He had a conflict. I did have a conversation with them. Things are going well. So I don't, if we had any questions, he said, please feel free to email him if you had any specific questions. So, Mr. Swartz, do you have any comments? Oh, okay. Does anybody have any questions for our chief academic officer? No, I guess we're familiar with the program. Thank you. Mr. Brinker. request approval of the revised job specifications for the position of Talent and Professional Development Supervisor.
Thank you. I feel more comfortable now. as we know, Dr. Tucker left us. Mm-hmm. When she did, the superintendent, Mr. Schwartz, and myself have met with other staff to look at the job description as it was currently written. It was written in June of 2012. We felt there was a need to make some revisions. It did go to the Personnel Committee. We did incorporate their changes into the new job description. We ask for your approval so that we can move forward with the processing and selection of the next talent and professional development supervisor.
Is it possible for you to just highlight the changes? Because I know we did have the original one that we asked for, and some of the committee members, some of the members were not on the committee. So it doesn't look dramatically different to me. So
it's not dramatically different. The first is the pay rate. We added the supervisor 12-month SAW rather than just SAW contract.
Okay.
So the person would know exactly what it is. Eliminated a mistype in the reporting relationship where it said collaboration with the director of personnel.
Right.
But it said director twice. That was just cleaning up the language. The duties, we added more with working with community groups.
Good. Okay.
Organizations, things of that nature.
Okay. Thank you. Commissioner Van Stone.
Thank you, Madam President. Bob, I hope I don't catch you a little off guard with this, but this job and expenditures by executive order were just closed down.
I was going to discuss that in executive session, but yes.
Well, we got an email, so it's...
Yes, the mayor...
It's open for the public if it's on my email.
The mayor has issued an executive order today that there's an immediate freeze on all hiring. Mm-hmm. Any request to hire must be personally approved by the mayor himself. Secondly, any request for purchasing of goods, services over $2,500 must be personally approved by the mayor himself. We sent out an email, Mrs. Biolo and myself, advising everybody of the freeze and that if they have anything that they want to fill, then they're to contact us. She and I will discuss it and we would move it forward to the mayor for discussion with him. At this point, what we'd like to do, though, is free up the job description so we're ready if there is a relaxation on the freeze, when or if.
Okay.
But at this point, you're correct, Commissioner. There is a freeze on all hiring for the city of Waterbury unless it's approved by the mayor.
Okay.
Not just education.
I only brought it up because I just happened to look at the email and so we got the memo.
Right. Thank you.
But it just reminds me that we've also been criticized for having excess at the end of the year in our budgets, and it was also years where freezes were put on. So we can't have it both ways. We can't be criticized for not spending our allocated money if we have freezes. So thank you.
But we do expect there will be those instances where the mayor would approve some filling of some vacancies. But I of course, I don't speak for the mayor.
Any questions? Commissioner Harvey.
Yeah. I have some comments, but I'm going to hold them. In light of that, If we're not going to be pursuing this with the mayor, I'm taking it, right?
I didn't say that.
Okay.
Well, Commissioner, I don't mean that bluntly, but any job that we desire to fill, we will discuss with the superintendent, of course, with Mr. Schwartz, myself, okay. Mrs. Biolo, come up to a consensus of an agreement, and then talk to the mayor and see if he would approve it. Would this be one of those jobs? Like, he wouldn't answer this right now.
Okay, so, but you can answer it at some point.
Yes.
I hope so, because the reason being, the governor just signed into a law into place regarding the hiring of minority teachers. That specifically references what this position is doing. So if we are not going to pursue this, which I hope we will, then what other alternatives? I'm just throwing this out, maybe rhetorical, but just something you think about because you're going to be hit with these questions. And what other things are we doing to ensure that we are going to continue with the hiring of Black and Hispanic educators?
Well, let me answer the first question without an answer to a question. I would expect this to be one of those that the mayor would approve going forward.
Okay.
To me, it's a critical vacancy. I believe we've made some headway with increasing the hiring of minority teachers. and I don't want to see it stopped. I think it's very important to the district and to the state that we continue with that. So this, to me, this would be the job that would suit what we would expect to go forward to the mayor for approval.
Okay.
But again, I don't speak for him.
All right, well, would you, okay, I understand that, but I would like to know, you know, talk it over obviously with the superintendent, but this is very critical here, because there have been promises that have been made to the state in regards to the hiring and retention of our Black and Hispanic educators. So I would be very interested in knowing whenever that discussion is taken, and this board, you know, enlightening us as to what the procedure is going to be, because if not, then that's going to put us in quite a predicament.
If we don't fill this position, it's just more work that myself and my staff would take on.
Oh, yeah.
That's just how it is. Somebody has to stand up and do the work.
Yeah, but we know that if when we had someone in this position, okay, what they did. So this is a very significant position. So I'll just wait. You can have your discussions, et cetera. But I know that we just lost two minority educators in the district, and we have a third one that we may lose. So I know there's a meeting on retention next week, which I hope to attend. So I'm just really kind of watching and see how we're going to move forward with this, or if we're going to move forward. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Commissioner Thurio.
I don't usually get involved in these particular battles, but with regard to the NAACP's complaint to the state, which the city worked very hard to defend with regard to minority retention and recruitment, this would certainly seem to be a slap in the face in telling the state we're trying all these ways to recruit minority people, and the very person that does the job, we have a job description and we're not going to replace them. So it just seems to me, out of a matter of good faith, while this case is continuing on, it would seem that if we were genuinely concerned about minority recruitment and retention, we would get this person on board as soon as possible. Just my own particular opinion. And as I say, I'm not usually involved in this particular aspect because I let it usually play out by the other board members, but I think fair is fair. Thank you.
Yeah, and I don't think in any way you've stated tonight that this we're not committed to moving this forward. There is a freeze. We'll move this forward, hopefully, and we will push to get it passed as a board. I think you see we really want this position to be filled. So thank you,
Madam President.
Any other discussion? Okay, thank you. Number 10, request permission be granted to Heidi Doolin, what will be high school and five chaperones, to take 40 students to New York on November 30th to attend a performance of The Color Purple. 11, request permission be granted to Michael Sullivan, Crosby High School, and three chaperones to take 25 students to Salem, Mass on November 17th to visit historical sites. And that one, we need a consensus this evening because the 17th is next week. Do I have a consensus on that one? Thank you. Number 12, use of school facilities by school organizations and or city departments. Number 13, use of school facilities by outside organizations and or waiver requests. 14, superintendent's notification to the board. And do we need an executive session? We do. Okay. So we will.
Motion to convene into executive session for discussion concerning the appointment, employment, performance evaluation, health, or dismissal of a public officer or employee.
Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Should we go in the back over there?
Yeah.
Right there.